please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Hello and welcome. You've joined us on Business Lunch. I'm Nisha Podar, and with me, as always, is Sonia Shenoy. Sonia, good afternoon. Markets in the red at this point, and Nifty 50, take a look at that. That has given up the 10,800 level as well, but it is flattish at the moment. It's the mid-caps who are taking a knock, and Bank Nifty is slightly better, though ICICI Bank is a big drag, Sonia.
Yes, it is, but the market is sort of reacting to a lot of results. South Indian Bank just came out of their numbers a while back, and that stock has surged right now, up almost about 5.5 to 6 odd percent. Sun TV, look at that, just in the last 5 minutes, a big bump up there. Sun TV is up almost about 11 odd percent, and on the downside, Tata Global Beverages is taking a big knock. So we'll talk about all of that in great detail, but first some macro data. April WPI inflation has come in at 3.18%, which is a 4-month high. Lata Venkatesh joins in to analyze these numbers for us. Lata, over to you.
Well, we would normally have called 3.18 a very good number, but it is just that the expectation was 2.9. And the bump up is coming because of food prices, which can always be very sensitive for CPI. So we are more worried about the impact on CPI, the food inflation going up. That's 0.67 year on year. If you looked month on month, that is April over March, then it's a 1.92% increase in food prices over a month, largely because of potatoes. Potatoes over the month went up 20%, and year on year it's more expensive. So that is the one that's taken the inflation higher. Fuel is another one you can complain, but that we all know has been rising, especially LPG prices. Now, for the impact on CPI. One must first put on the table that WPI tends to exaggerate both sides. When it falls, it can remain negative for a very long time. When it rises, it shoots up to CPI. CPI is a more sedate index. Now, that said, our poll was indicating that CPI, which is going to come out later today at 5:30, will show a 4.45 number. After looking at this WPI, especially the food component, people have started revising it higher to over 4.5. Now, the other point people point out is that food inflation will be less important. CPI, people will be looking at what you call core inflation, which is remove the food part and remove the fuel part. Non-food, non-fuel, which is the part that people will look at, that anyway was expected to come at 6% compared to 5.37, and Reserve Bank watches that very closely. Now, all that is bad news. What is the good news? Perhaps all this is in the price. Anyway, the bond market is broken. PSU banks are not buying bonds. So at 7.75% in the morning, it was 7.71 before the WPI numbers came. That rise in yield is largely because of the WPI number. At 7.75, people have priced in about 2 rate hikes at least. And therefore, that 10-year part will not change much because of the CPI number. But nevertheless, it's not good for anyone if prices show such an uptrend.
All right, Lata, thanks so much for getting us all those details. Now, the eyes would be on CPI inflation numbers as well. Now, moving on to some important earnings of the day, and all eyes would be on Hindustan Unilever. The stock is a little subdued in trade ahead of the numbers today, but it has had a stellar run, and the growth that the company really projects is going to be something to watch out for. Mangalam Malu is giving us a heads up on what to expect. Mangalam.
Absolutely. Subdued in trade today, but remember, it is virtually at a record high, up 80% from the start of 2017, added close to about 1.5 to 2 lakh crore in terms of market cap. So with that backdrop, we are expecting a good set of numbers. A couple of things that we need to keep an eye out on. First up is the domestic volume growth. Remember, HUL's foreign parent Unilever PLC in their first quarter results for 2018 said that India in this quarter witnessed broad-based volume growth across categories. So that is something that the street is going into these results expecting. 6 to 8% is the range that our poll throws up. So that is something we'll be watching out for. Another thing we'll be watching out for is an expansion of 120 basis points on the EBITDA. So EBITDA margins seen around that 21.3% mark, primarily on account of improved product mix, improved GST offsets, as well as the management's focus on cost control. Most importantly, we'll be watching out for qualitative commentary from the company with regards to new product launches, rural recovery, and the input cost inflation. That is something we'll be watching out for. Also, numbers we're looking out for, 8.5% growth on the top line, close to 8,900 crore is what the street is working with, 21.3% EBITDA margins, which is a 100-120 basis points improvement. as well as a net profit growth of close to around 14.5% on the back of strong revenue growth as well as 14.5% EBITDA growth. So net profit of around that 1350 crore mark is something that the street is working with.
Okay, thanks a lot for that. And the stock is at a new high beyond that 1500 mark now. And its market cap, by the way, has hit more than 3.5 lakh crores. Well, things are looking subdued across the mid-cap market. Tata Global Beverages has gotten hit very hard. It's in fact lost all of the ground it had covered over the last 6 months in this move today. So just pull up a 6 months chart. It's done nothing. And of course, we saw the numbers as well this time around. Ashok Leyland is the other one. It's actually seeing some profit taking right now. So maybe that's the order of the day, profit taking in the mid-cap market. Across the globe, Asian markets closed higher and European stocks opened mixed amidst a more positive sentiment towards trade relations between the US and China. US President Donald Trump said in a tweet that he was working with the Chinese President Xi Jinping to give Chinese telecommunications equipment maker ZTE a way to get back into business very fast. Right. Let's talk about some stocks in our own markets, right? Emphasis saw a big block deal this morning as the promoter Blackstone sold 8% stake at 960 rupees per share. Nisha, tell us more about that.
Yeah, the large transaction, Sonia, and it was in the waiting because Blackstone, which had 60% stake, did have the headroom to pare it down and still retain its control. And remember that Emphasis stock has done so well in the last 1 year that it could have really required a profit booking by Blackstone as well. So yes, the stock is still above 1,000 rupees per share, even though the huge block deal of 8% stake by Blackstone has really taken place at 960 rupees per share. So in fact, some of the marquee players who have gotten in, some of the large FIIs like Oppenheimer, T. Rowe Price, as well as Aberdeen, must be already happy because they have bought it at 960 odd rupees per share and the stock has already crossed 1,000 rupees per share. But remember that Blackstone is going to retain its control and probably at an opportune time, at a more ripe time, would sell this to a strategic with a big fat return. They've already booked a huge amount of profit here. Let's also hear out the management of Emphasis on this large transaction.
The idea was to create more liquidity in the stock and, you know, still continue to retain a controlling position. And from that perspective, I think nothing much changes from my point of view and the management's point of view. You know, I think they've very clearly said that that they don't intend this anymore because their global, you know, positioning always has to have control positions. And I don't think that theory is going to play out.
Okay, well, let's move on to the PSU banks now. Canara Bank has posted a howler this quarter owing to a divergence and the highest ever quarterly slippages. We did speak to Rakesh Sharma, the MD and CEO of Canara Bank. He expects improvement in asset quality by September 2018. Listen in.
Our target is, you know, during the current year, the growth, overall growth will be 10 to 12%. But mainly the retail will grow by 20 to 25%. And we have been growing more or less in the same line. And SME around 10%, agriculture also 10 to 12%.
Quarterly slippages. We did speak to Rakesh Sharma, the MD and CEO of Canara Bank. He expects improvement in asset quality by September 2018. Listen in.
Our target is, you know, during the current year, the growth, overall growth will be 10 to 12%. But mainly the retail will grow by 20 to 25%. And we have been growing more or less in the same line. And SME around 10%, agriculture also 10 to 12%, and corporate 7 to 8%. So that is our target. By our, you know, efforts are that by September, our gross NPA should come down around 9.5% and net NPA below 5.5%.
All right, let's also focus on Sun TV. That stock is up over 11% in trades currently, and that is a good showing for the quarterly results. Reported a strong set of numbers for the fourth quarter with ad revenue growth, which has seen a 26%. Sonal is joining in to get us a detailed analysis of the company's performance. Sonal, tell us.
Thanks a lot for that, Nisha. Well, you know, the stock has actually underperformed this year. It was down around 14%, but the move on the stock today has actually been able to pair off almost all the losses that it made. In terms of ad revenue growth, that was a multi-year high at around 26%. We estimated a growth of around 21%. The subscription revenue growth came in at 28% versus our estimate of 19%. Overall, the growth in revenues was around 23% versus an estimate of around 17%. In terms of EBITDA margin, also the street likes the EBITDA margins because they came in higher by 530 basis points. Despite the fact that we estimated that content costs will go up, management also guided for a strong domestic subscription revenue growth at 20 to 25%. Also, they expect the margins to improve as IPL business business is expected to turn profitable in FY19. All the brokerages are quite sanguine. In fact, Nomura has upgraded the stock to a buy. CLSA has increased the EPS targets by 6 to 8% for FY19. And all of them, like Nomura, ICICI Securities, Macquarie, have a rating of either buy or outperform. And the target prices, they are varying from 1,000 to 1,250 rupees. And they have a very positive outlook on the company going forth.
Okay, thanks a lot for that. Well, can't say the same about South Indian Bank, or in fact, you know, not as much maybe. It isn't focused at the company, reported its numbers just a short while ago. Abhishek joins in with the analysis of the company's performance. Abhishek, actually the stock has now started to move up quite a bit, 6.5%. But there are problems with asset quality, right?
Well, Sonia, going into the results, it was towards a 52-week low and it has corrected from 35 rupees level. Now, looking at the results, you know, optically it looks very good, but there are minute details which can be a trigger of worry. Now, looking at the loan growth, which used to be between 10 to 13% is now on a steady basis above 16% level. So 17.6% is the highest loan growth that they have seen in 7 quarters. You look at the slippages of about 614 crore, there are one-offs. So if you remove the one-offs which the management mentioned due to RBI scheme, it comes down to 130-140 crores. So on two consecutive quarters, they have been able to maintain their slippages below 150 crore. Otherwise, the slippages had been trending between 250 crore plus. So if you look at that, the net interest margin also is now steady at 2.8% plus. So these are the three positive. However, the niggling worry is that the P&L growth is not in line with balance sheet growth. You look at the NII, that has come in at 492 crore versus Prabhudas Leeladhar at 536 crore, and the PAT has come in at 114 crore versus Prabhudas Leeladhar at 124 crore. Back to you.
All right. Thanks so much, Abhishek, for getting us all those details. Nile Limited, on back of those results, has a quick check on the markets, and they've weakened in the last few minutes of trade. In fact, Nifty 50 is at 10,788 levels and showing at the lowest point in the day. So keep an eye out on that one. Mid-caps actually have plummeted more than the frontline indices, almost 1% down now. Bank Nifty is more flattish. Some of the counters which are really showing weakness and are at pretty much the lowest point are the counters like Titan. Tech Mahindra has plummeted very sharply. Z Entertainment, India Bulls Housing Finance. So keep an eye out on the markets as well. But we'll take it straight to some news development. And government officials tell CNBC TV 18 that the finance ministry will meet the PSBs for a performance review this month. Sapna Das, my colleague, gets us all those important details. Tell us, Sapna.
Hi. So basically, the update here is that this time around, the meeting with the public sector banks and government is going to happen in two stages. First, of course, it will be those 11 banks which are under the RBI's firm corrective action, and the second stage will be those banks which are not under the PCA. So those 11 banks are basically where the attention is. Pretty much the spotlight is over there as of now. Friday, we had noticed what RBI has said in terms of Dena Bank, which is already under PCA, saying that there can be further restrictions in terms of credit exposure and also no fresh hiring. So we have to wait and watch and see what really happens and what is the government's take on this front. What about the other banks which are under PCA? We also get to hear that by 17th of May, because generally it's expected that the results of most of these banks will be in by then, barring one or two. Apart from this, the other tranche of banks will happen sometime most likely in the last week of May. So this is a complete performance review, as you have rightly pointed out. There will be clear-cut quarterly goals that we set in terms of what the cycle of intent is going to be, how the quarterly trend is going to look like in terms of recovery. In fact, there's a meeting just tomorrow via video conference of the recovery officers of various banks and the finance ministry over here. So a lot of action can be expected in the month of May. Of course, this is all in the backdrop of whatever has happened in terms of Syndicate Bank, Indian Bank, Allahabad Bank, the Punjab National Bank management. So those are also issues that need to be watched out. Basically, lots happening, but we need to get more details in terms of how this review is going to go forward, because this is the first year after the scams wherein, two groups have been formed, two buckets have been formed, and it's a different scenario that we're looking at.
Oh, absolutely. Thanks a lot for that. We'll keep coming back to you for more. But to move on, the unfortunate thunderstorm across North India and some other parts of the country has claimed at least 62 lives, we understand. In New Delhi, life was thrown out of gear and flight flight operations had to be suspended at the Delhi airport for nearly an hour. Several metro lines stopped services for over 30 minutes. Heavy rains and hailstorms were seen across North India, hitting road traffic. The Met Department has said that fresh storms will hit North India in the next few days as well.
All right, let's take it straight to some market opinion also coming in. Let's hear out what Nilesh Shah, the MD at Kotak Mahindra AMC, has to say on the key triggers for the markets going forward.
Overall, if we see dispassionately the result trend, that's fairly good. The urban consumption is at a reasonably good pace. The rural consumption in the form of tractor sales also indicates that there is a fair amount of momentum there. The microfinance institutions have also reported recovery in their recovery rate. So put all these things together, consumption seems to be doing well. At least that's what is visible from the results declared so far. We still think there is little bit more pain to come in the corporate sector lending, especially related to power sector. Now there has been certain improvement in terms of merchant power prices as well as volume. But we still think there are many uncompleted projects, under construction projects, which are yet to be recognized for NPA by the banking sector. So while a lot of other sectors have been cleared out, the NCLT process has been good, we still think that power sector NPAs are yet to be fully disclosed and yet to be fully factored in by the market.